Hi YouTube. Here we have my newly purchased Tronxy X3 3D printer, which we're going to begin assembling. See my previous video for the unboxing. And let's begin. So, sorry about that, but it appears that about an hour into my assembly, the battery in my camera went dead, and I was so focused on the build that I didn't really notice the camera wasn't working anymore. So we missed about an hour's worth of assembly. So just to play catch up, what I have so far is I have the gantry started, and the majority of the base complete along with the Y-axis assembly. The belt for the Y-axis assembly goes around the back, underneath, through the underneath inside of this 2020 extrusion, out around the front. I did have one issue when installing this bracket. The end stops were pre-installed, and this end stop was installed upside down, so I had to flip it around, no big deal. I also installed the motors for the Z-axis, and I was in the process of attaching the gantry, but before I do that I want to make sure everything is straight on the gantry. So I'm going to set that for a moment. Slide right on here. It doesn't run very smooth, but I'm not sure if that's because I'm lacking this top assembly at the moment. I'm gonna install this just to see if that smoothens out the Z-axis. Actually, next thing I'm going to do is actually install my extruder motor, and then this gets installed later. I don't want to skip ahead in steps in case installing this right now causes problems later on. So let's install our extruder motor. There's our hot end, all metal black plate, all metal shroud. There's a place here to mount additional mounting point for a cooling fan for the filament, which I do plan to add. That'll be an update that I must have update. Okay, so I don't have any more of the little inserts left that'll hold parts into place, and I need at least three. So let's go see what I've got in my bag of tricks. Okay, here are some of my spare printer parts. As I said, these parts are because I own a few Cosmo Minis and a large Delta, so I have a lot of printers with 2020 extrusion on it. And otherwise, I'd be pretty upset because I'd be stopped right now. I wouldn't be able to put these end stops on. So, fortunately for me, I have a lot of the little inserts on hand. Otherwise, I'd have to make do with something else or order them online and wait for them to get in. Now, that being said, I don't see the little screws that I need. I have one more left in this kit. And there are no others. That's what you get when they just throw a bag of crap together. They don't label it. It's just a bunch of miscellaneous junk. So I don't even know if these screws will fit these. I might have a different thread size. I think I have M3 and the ones that were here are M4. So let me go and get some more of my goodies because I'm going to need more of them. Okay, so not only was I shorted the inserts, little guys that look like this, but they're M4 thread, these are M3. I was also shorted the screws, which wouldn't matter anyways because they wouldn't fit this. I have one of the screws left and I need three more of each. And there's nothing on the floor. The bag I opened here, it was all miscellaneous crap stuck together. So, fortunately for me, I have a bag of my own parts that I could use to make up for this. But if this was my first printer and I didn't have these supplies, I'd be pretty upset because I would be stuck. I would be able to get the rest of it built, but I would be stuck with I wouldn't be able to put my end steps on. Sure, I could make do somehow, but it just, it wouldn't be the same. I wouldn't feel like it was done right. These end steps have a little roller on them, but it's kind of pointless because the way this is going to go on here, this bracket is going to hit right here instead of the actual shell, the shroud. Makes me wonder if I put anything on there, I'm going to have to be wary of that. These two are also so close together, they're hitting each other. Okay, what do I need? Too small. This one seems too big. You know, look at that. Okay. Let's see if these fit. So let's get these in here. These inserts are a little higher end than the cheap piece of crap that come with the thing. So I'm using a couple of these. They also have the same threading as the inserts that came with it, but the difference in quality. These have a very good chance of spinning around. Well, these do not. But I didn't want to use all of what I have in my spares box just for a printer that should come with everything. Cheaping out on the inserts. Okay. And I just need some bigger M4 screws. Which I'm short on. I might have two here. Let's see here. So I want to put a spacer there and I want that end stop out further. I want the end stop out here. I want to hit this. I don't want to be clicking on this and hitting it twice and causing issues. Okay, so there we go. I have just enough. Two large M4s. Where I can put a space around here. And I actually should have some bushing somewhere. I'm just gonna go get them. Should be in one of my other boxes. Okay, perfect. Okay, so I actually have some little black spacers that I can use to offset this, and it would actually match the color scheme of the printer.
see what that'll do though. Still not enough. Not enough space yet. Okay, let's see what this does. There. So now I'm hitting the frame. That's too loose. I don't like that. Okay, moving on. I'll come back to that later. Just to see if they'll fit on that, because if they don't, I'll take, put one of my own inserts on there. Or one of my own end stops on. So here's one of my own end stops. They don't have the wheel. Unnecessary. This works much better. I don't have any interference. So I'm probably going to take this off and put this on. It comes with quick disconnects, so I can keep this off until I actually need to hook it up instead of this little weld job where they break apart. So I think I'm going to put my own on here, take this piece of crap off. The little ball is cool and all, but it's actually, it works against itself. So if I come down and I hit the ball and then I slip, which is what was happening here, it does the opposite effect of what I want. So let's get rid of this end stop. Put one of my own on. I don't have too many end stops right, well, that's not true. I have like a couple dozen. I have end stops that have the light on them that show you that they're active. That usually comes standard on like a Prusa i3. I don't want to use those on here though. I can't, they make a little high pitched noise, and I really don't need a light to come on an end stop to tell me that, yeah, okay, I'm home. So far, I'm short screws. There's a belt that's just too short. Like, it's long enough just to reach both sides underneath, but not long enough to zip tie both sides. So, and then I've got this end stop that the weld came off of. And, I'm going to have to change ends on this maybe. We'll see. We'll see what we have to do here. I prefer this color anyways. I can't stand these yellow wires. They just... Even though everything's going to be... Let's see how that'll function. See, that's much better. I know that wheel is going to hit that end stop right on, and it's not going to slip. It's going to function much better. I'm debating on replacing all three of them. This one should be fine, spaced out like that. But it's in the way of, if I want to put active cooling on the filament, it's going to be. Didn't want to use them because I only have a handful of them, but I do have another type of insert that can go in these and it won't spin, but I really don't want to use them because I only have a few. Anyways, let me go grab one and I'll show you what I mean. Okay, so I have three types of inserts here. I have this little guy. Let's get this printer over here for
for a second.
Anyway, so I have this little guy. I have this big guy. This guy spins. This is what this came with, this type. I have a short three, but I have tons of them. Just a smaller thread. Then I have this guy, which is the same thread as the little ones that were in here, but it's bigger. It doesn't spin. But you need to put this in the extrusion before you cap the ends, or else you can't get it in. But then I have another type. Another type that's kind of a in between the two, and it's the best features of both. This one right here, this little square one. Now, it'll spin slightly, but it won't spin all the way around. And you can also get it in from the sides without having to have access to the end of the extrusion. But I only have a handful of these. Fortunately, I only need one. So that's what we're going to do. That's going to be my solution, instead of messing around and taking this all apart. Personally, I have my extruder, since it's a Bowden style on this thing, I'd have it on the same side as my X-axis motor. That way I get all my wiring neatly on one side. I don't have to screw around wiring over here and wiring over here. If this extruder was over here with my end stops over here as they are, all my wiring would come out this side. I wouldn't need to mess around with anything. But right now as it is, I got wires over here and I got wires over here. And I don't know if they did this for a balancing act. They have a motor here and a motor here to keep this balanced. I have no idea. What's it matter? You have two threaded rods. You have two big beefy Z motors on the Z axis. Who cares about that? Put it here. Make another bracket. Put it here. Wire it there. Have all your wiring come out in one spot. You got your end stops here, your end stops here. You got your motor back there, your end stop there. All your wiring comes out to here. You can braid that nicely. You don't have braided wire over here. So you can take this, you can put this in a cable chain. But no, let's have it all over the place. Suppose I should zip tie those. The manual calls for it, but it's so tight in there, it took forever to get them in there because it's really not loose enough to pull them up inside. I had to actually use a pair of needle-nose pliers to pull on it. I don't think the zip ties are necessary, but it comes with them. That's what they're for, so that's what we'll do with them. My level of frustration has gone down a bit since I realized I had a solution at hand, but still shouldn't have this issue. And for anybody out there watching this video interested in getting one of these, if you do, just make sure, go, like if you're going to get one on AliExpress or something, go look up the inserts for these printers, the little angle inserts, and maybe a little bit of belt or something. I'd probably get a couple spare end stop switches to go with the kit. These aren't much. End stops are maybe about $1.50. You can get 2 meters of belt for another $2. 2 meters of belt will be more than enough to do this printer. The little inserts that go inside the extrusion, you can get probably 20 of those for $5. And then you'll have spare parts. But if you're going to, but that goes for any kit. If I were going to get any kit online and I don't already have spare parts there, I'm going to order spare parts. Okay, so we're as far as we're going to go on this. For this, we're going to work on the case for the electronics, because that's where the manual tells us to go next. So So we're going to turn this around, we're going to put the printer to the side, and we're going to begin on the electronics case. I think I mentioned in the unboxing that the power supply was just 20 amp. Now there might be some 250 watts. There will be some people that will argue with me that that'll be enough to power this printer, and I'm going to disagree. 220 amp is basically just enough to power this printer. A 200 by 200 heated bed with all the electronics on the printer, including the LCD, I'm going to run this thing at maximum output all the time if I got that heated bed going. Ideally, you want something with like a little bit, like overhead, like 30% overhead is good, because if I run this thing all the time with that heated bed going, this thing will probably last me maybe a month before it blows. Really, what should be with this, what should be a 30 amp, 360 watts. Then I got some overhead. I'm not pushing the thing to its limit every time I run it. Okay, so we're going to put the printer itself aside, and we're going to focus on the housing and the electronics next. So let's clear up some stuff here. Like, there's one thing I'll give the printer credit. It's a nice looking printer. It's pretty sturdy. There's no wobble in this frame. I was doubtful on it because it's just one length of 2020. I was worried that there's going to be a lot of backlash, but it's pretty strong. We have an acrylic at work that I put together for the place of business where I work, just so they can try out 3D printing. And it's a piece of crap. Like, I can move that thing around. It's not meant to. I can wiggle it. I can bend it. It's not meant to be picked up and lugged around. But this thing is rugged. Like, and I mean rugged. I can't flex that. I can't. And another thing I was impressed with were the motors. These aren't cheap motors. These are like pretty beefy. These are 42 millimeter motors. They got to be 48. Somewhere between 48 and 62 ounce. Somewhere around there. I can't really tell because they don't really give me. Yeah, there's a part number on there, but it's not something I'm familiar with. And they're branded Tronxy, so it might be their part number specific, because it's not what I'm familiar with. But I know they're almost as big as the motors I have on my mostly printed CNC, and those are 68 ounce holding torque on those. And they're really beefy, and I got them really beefy so that, for the CNC. But these are pretty beefy. The two Z-axis motors, they're all the same size. So I'm impressed with that. I'm impressed with the frame. It's much more durable than I thought. There are some components in it that look like they're fairly high-end, but then they cheap out. And they cheap out on the areas that don't make sense. The screws in the little bag all lumped in together like that. That shows me carelessness. And then there's screws missing. If anything, for the pennies that the screws are worth, I'd put extra screws in the bag. Like, what's an extra 50 cents? That would get you an extra 3 or 4 screws, an extra 3 or 4 inserts. And the inserts too, they're cheap inserts. You don't have to get the bigger ones that I have here that you need to slide in. You can get the little square ones that are the best of both worlds in between the two. You don't need to have the end of the extrusion open, but when you put them in from the front, they don't spin around. And they're no more expensive than the smaller ones. They're actually easier to machine. So, you know, switch to something like that. And another thing, this thing here, like, come on, 20 amp, 30 amp is like $2 or $3 more in gross price. I mean, like, if you're going to go all out, you're going to go like powder coated 2020 extrusion, you're going to go high end motors, you're going to go to all metal hot end, you might as like, what's like, if you're going to spend that much on all of that, why cheap out in the other areas? Like, I don't understand. I can't wait to get to this board, this all-in-one board. I'm really disappointed in that. I really didn't know about that until on Gearbest, somebody else asked the question after I purchased the printer, what the board was that came, the logic board that came with the printer. And then I had to look it up, and I wasn't really impressed with it at all. I prefer
I know rhombus. I don't have anything with a rhombus board. Those things that are a lot more versatile than ramps. But really, ramps, it's when you have an Arduino with the ramps, you can do a lot more than you think. You can upgrade that. You can buy a CNC add-on board. There's still a lot of connections on the Arduino that you can wire into the add-on CNC board. I have a couple in the other room where I have a diamond hot end and I want to run three extruders. You just wire up the CNC board. You wire power to the CNC board. You wire it to the Arduino. And then you're good to go. You have four more stepper drivers right there. So... And it's just a little bit of know-how. But the board that comes with this, I'm restricted there. There's one extruder, there's one stepper driver built into it for the extruder. So if I ever want to do dual hot ends on this or something, I'm not going to be able to do that. That isn't my purpose for it, but I'm limited. I don't like being limited. I like the fact that it has an MK3. Heated bed instead of an MK2, because that means it's got the aluminum build plate built into it, but what I'm, and it's got their name on it too. What I'm not impressed with this heated bed, and say I don't want to use a lot of heat, if I use a lot of heat it might take it out, but if I'm printing PLA, that temperature's not going to take that bow out of that heated bed, and it's bowed both ways. It's cupped in all four corners. So I'm definitely going to need a piece of glass for this. And it's a shame too, because like the MK3 heated beds are pretty nice. I actually didn't check this, but I should check. This is the heated area between these lines here. And the printer is supposed to be able to print 220 by 220. But that doesn't necessarily mean that this is 220 by 220 heated area. So the heated bed itself is 220, but the heated area on the heated bed is, if I'm going to have to guess and put this to the 100 and read it, is only 200. So running this heated bed, this 200 millimeter heated area, with this printer, if I was running this with PL or ABS, this would be running at maximum capacity. There would be no headroom. I would basically be pulling out between 240 and 250 watts out of this when you add up all the components together. And I'd be running this at full capacity all the time. Said that, doing that will shorten the life of this power supply. This power supply is not intended for this printer. It's like you see a lot of them with these, but you'll also find a lot of people online that these don't last very long. Really, for about $2 or $3 more in the build cost of this, and probably less for them because they're buying these parts in bulk from a manufacturer there in China who's probably next door to them, they could upgrade this to a 30 amp 360 watt, which would mean I'd have about 30% headroom. I'd never be running this at maximum capacity, and the lifetime of this power supply would be a lot longer. But given that, when I usually make my custom printers, I'm usually using a PCATX power supply. I usually take it apart, I rip out what I don't want, and I keep what I want, and I braid it, and then I shrink wrap the ends, and I give myself a 12 volt, an extra 12 volt, a 5 volt, an extra 5 volt with quick disconnect, so I can plug it in and unplug it. Because I know I have a lot more, there's a lot more security. Moving on, we're going to set this aside, and we're going to begin assembly of the case. And it is a fairly big printer. It's bigger than your standard i3, right? They're not going to print as high as this printer is going to print. But we'll test that out. We'll do all the movements on it and everything when it's set up and we have the software installed. And I like that it's all metal. I can't stand acrylic printers. I won't own one ever. And I don't care about anybody out there that says, oh, they work wonders for me. I've had one printing hundreds of hours. They're great. Based on my personal experience with them and hands-on assembling, and not the first printers I've assembled, I personally think they're garbage. Now, I've not had one from China. I've worked on one from the U.S. from a certain company I won't name. They begins with the letter F, an acrylic printer from them. There's no LCD. You can't print from the printer. Meaning there's no SD card slot. The motors are like this big, and you run the thing for 15 minutes and they burn. Like if you touch them, you'll be burned. And cheap acrylic. I mean cheap. Like this stuff here, this feels solid, but the minute I put my hands in the acrylic for this particular printer I'm talking about, it felt cheap. And it spider cracked easy. So, anyways, I'm ranting on. Let's get back to the build. Oh, let's get some cable management going here. There's a mock-up of what it'll look like. I got an extra wire here, so if I want to run the smart cooling for this, I can run it. I don't have to undo anything. All my wiring is nice and neatly hidden. Yeah, doesn't look too bad. Everything moves smoothly. No jamming of this. No jamming of the hotbed cable. I put two pieces of shrink wrap, one over the other there, to give that more durability. And zip tied it over here on a 45 so that it comes around when I come to the back. It comes around. Otherwise, if I came straight back with it, it would curl up or curl under and put a lot of strain on the welds. Nope. That is the printer. I just have to do the wiring in the box and finish putting the box together. Let's take a look at it. Let's take a look all around with the printer. I got my cable management here. I wish I could do better, like maybe if I had more wiring to work with. And I had some black filament available, I'd print a chain for the thing. And I'd figure out how to wire that. And there's the box. And connectors on the side. You have, it's a little dark, but there's a micro USB right here. This is our micro USB. We have a micro SD card slot right here. It's a little dark. It's hard to see. We have our USB port. And that's it for connectors there. I wish this was a little more. Might print something to go there. And all our wire cable management here in the back. Okay. Here we go. I got the flash on the phone so we could see here. So here's all my cable management. So I got this double, I got the two pieces of shrink wrap on there. And okay, here's a better shot here. Here's the micro SD card slot and the USB port to connect it to the PC. A little dusty. You can see my cable management here. I still have to finish wiring up inside the box. It's just mocked up right now. I just wanted to get a good view of the idea of the cable management I have going here. I gotta fix that. That's slipping out. I gotta take a look at that. I took the screw out of here. I didn't like how what I had there, and I didn't like the two lines there. So what I did is I zip tied the two together. I think that gives it a cleaner look. Gives it a much cleaner look. And it's, the cables are all nice and neat. I just have this one little wire showing here that I'm going to use for when I print myself a bracket and a fitting for a fan to cool the filament. And that is already going to be in the box. I said this is just mocked up for now. This is just mocked up.
There's nothing in set up right away in there as of yet. We'll finish doing that, and then we'll install the firmware, and then that'll be the end of the build video. So I did the wiring in the box offline, as there wasn't really much to see there. I turned the rat's nest into something remotely resembling order. There's a lot of wiring in there, so you're going to get something that does look a little messy, but that's still pretty well organized for what it is. Everything's now wired up. I even have my extra fan line hooked up here for when I want to run a fan on the device itself. We have our X-axis motor, Y-axis motor, Z-axis motors, extruder, heated power supply, heated bed, hot end. This is the other fan port for your filament fan, which is not provided with this. Here's your active cooling fan. We have our end stops here. So our Z end stop. X end or Y end stop and X end stop. Here we have our temperature sensor for our bed, and temperature sensor for our extruder, temperature sensor for our hot end, and then the cable for our LCD. And that's the wiring. That's the wiring for inside the box for the X3 printer. So we're looking under the build plate, and I've added this one minor modification here. If you see that, this little plate right here. And what that's going to do is that's going to hit my Y end stop, because after I set the printer up and just homed everything, even though I got a bigger mirrored bed on here, I was still in the home position. I was out here right here where my finger is past the bed. And that's because my end stop wasn't being triggered until it hit this wheel. So I've added this, I've drilled two holes in the acrylic plate. I've added this little plastic angle bracket. And it's out about 20 mil from the wheel. And that should make it so that my home position is right here in this corner. So we'll see when we turn it around. Since I did the wiring, I have added a nice mirrored bed. And it is angled here on the edges. I couldn't find anything flat all the way out. If I can, I'll purchase something else. And it is two-sided taped to the aluminum build plate for now. But we're going to see how that works out. So here's the printer up and running just hours after I finished doing the wiring. And one nice thing about this printer is I didn't have to install the firmware. It already came preloaded on the board. So that was nice right out of the box. No messing around with the firmware. And it's set to have a maximum parameters on the Y-axis of 230. We can go a little bigger on that Y-axis. We're limited on the X-axis, but as you can see here, my mirror gives me a little bit extra on either side. If I could find a mirror that's flat here, I could get about 250 50 millimeter on the x-axis, and on the y-axis, if I can somehow edit the firmware on here, I could get up to 260. But right now, I'm limited to 2, even though the details on the printer say 220 by 220. That is the size of the build plate. But right now, with the mirror on here, I can go a maximum of 230 by 230. The firmware won't let me go any further. So let's see with that custom bracket underneath if that fixed my issue with my home position being out past the edge of the build plate. Let's connect to the printer and let's home it. So, right there. And that's with me adding a bracket in underneath, putting it out 20 mil. So as you can see, I'm right near the edge here. And I'm actually on the angle part of my mirror. And unfortunately, there's nothing else I could do about that at the moment. I prefer my home position to be in a little further. If I can get a mirror that's flat on all the edges, then I'm looking at a little bit bigger build area on this printer. I'm looking maybe 230 on the X, and if I can adjust that firmware somehow I can get 250 on the Y. I haven't tested the limits of the Z axis yet, as I've just started setting up the bed itself, and I do like that mirror look. I like that much better. It's a thicker piece of mirror. It's 5 millimeters, so I'll lose that on my overall height, but I'm not too concerned with that, because when I measure this, it's actually slightly taller than 300, and we're gonna find that out here in a minute. I'm gonna raise this up and I'm gonna measure this. It's really nice hardware here on the threaded rods. This one here has a little bit of slop, which concerns me. This one over here is nice and tight, but this one here has a little bit of slop.